Yeah, so basically I'm in charge of this whole engine behind me. I have to basically know everything that involves the engine, from the engine itself, like the motor, to the water pump, to all the tools that are on it, to how much hose we have on it. We have a 1500 gallon per minute tank or pump. So it's a pretty fast paced job. So I've been with Kentwood, come June will be 5 years. A firefighter total would be around 8 to 9 years.
As the lieutenant here, I'm on assigned to engine 53. We have five people at this fire station. There's two of us lieutenants, one equipment operator, two firefighters. I manage day-to-day operations. I make sure that the calls get run appropriately. I make sure that they get handled, that we do our jobs, everything's done correctly. We have a good time, and everybody goes home safe at the end of the shift. We run three different crews through three different shifts. We have an A and a B and a C shift. Each shift consists of two lieutenants, one equipment operator, and two firefighters. We run engine 53 and medic 53 out of the fire station. So that's five. And then with the three shifts, that makes 15. We work 24 and a quarter hours. So we start at 6:45 in the morning. We get done 7 o'clock the next morning. Gives us about 15 minutes of overlap where we do a little shift exchange. People get ready and then the oncoming shifts come on. They get their gear by whatever rig they're on, and the others pick their stuff up and go home. We get 24 hours off. Our second day is another 24 hour shift. We get the fourth day off, and then we work the fifth day. So we work 3 out of 5. We get 4 off at the end. Comes out to about 10 days a month. We have our day-to-day activities. We're very active. We do inspections, billing inspections. We do re-inspections. We go out and we tour facilities, and we keep very busy throughout the day. Gets to be our downtime at night, usually after 5 o'clock. We get to relax. We hang out together as a crew and play games, play basketball. At night, usually to say that we sleep, you really don't sleep well here. You know, it's more resting between calls. You never know when you're going to get a call. That's always on your mind. It's really hard to just relax. It's not like we're at home or on vacation. And so sometimes you run a couple calls at night. Sometimes you're up all night. I think back to when I first started on, you know, every time I heard a noise, I was ready to go, because you just don't know, right? And usually in the middle of the night, something happens, the alarm goes off. I think your mind knows that you're not at home, and you pop up pretty quickly.
Yeah, I can say that being a new guy, when you're a new guy here, you don't want to miss a call. Like, you want to go on that call. So it's important to hear that call when it goes out, so you get the first on the engine. And if you don't wake up for that call, that's a bad day. But yeah, a lot of it is just being excited to be here, and they want to run calls. We have a lot of new guys here, and they want to run them, so they're going to wake up for them. There was a study about when the alarms used to go off, they were very loud and like an abrupt alarm. But now they've realized that with this study, that a gradual tone is easier on your heart, because if you hear that loud tone at 3 o'clock in the morning, you're automatically, you know, you're going to start getting an increased heart rate. You're already starting to kind of getting some anxiety, if you will. So then the gradual thing will help reduce that, which is beneficial for everybody, really.
We used to get a phone call from dispatch, and now we're on the 900 megahertz system. And so we have a station alerting. So at the Kent County Communications Center, which is a Kent County Sheriff Department, they dispatch us. They hit a button, and then it transmits over our intercom. And then they'll say, Medic 53 or Engine 53, and they'll tell us what we have, and they'll give us the address, and then we just get up and come out.
So I grew up in the Chicago area, and I have a cousin that works for Deerfield Bannockburn Fire Department. And ever since I was a little kid, I always wanted to do that. And we also had some close family friends who were a firefighter in our local department, where I used to live in Evanston. And I would go there after school, and the firefighters would basically treat me like I was one of their kids. So after school, when my parents were still working, I would go hang out at the firehouse until they were done working, they would pick me up. So I was immersed in that whole environment my whole childhood, and that's something that I never wanted to leave, and I'm still stuck here.
This is all I've ever wanted to do. is be on the fire department. I've never wanted to do anything else. And it was just something about, used to hang out with Brent Lohman, who now, you know, we were buddies growing up. Now he's the fire chief. And when his dad was on the fire department, and we would see him go to calls and we'd hear about him, and that just kind of caught me. So as I grew up, it never left. And so now I get on the fire department, and I've had a few different jobs, and work as a plumber. I worked in a factory, and man, nothing beats the fire department. This is the greatest job in the world. And I still feel that to this day. When you're young, you see the big red fire engines, you see the lights, and you hear the sirens, and that's what captures you. You really don't know what all goes on. As I get older, yeah, you get in and you start to see the impact that you make, and it kind of gives you satisfaction, right? So then we'd go out on a call, and then people would come up. Maybe they're in a bad situation. They're very appreciative of you being there or whatever you've done. Yeah, it makes you feel good. Knowing you're doing the right thing, you're helping somebody who's in need, helping them with something that they can't take care of themselves.
And I think too, though, like kind of what Jeff was saying, when you see a fire truck go by, you think they're kind of going to a fire. You don't necessarily understand that they might be going to a cardiac arrest, or they could be going to something else that isn't necessarily a fire. And then joining the fire service, you learn that, and it kind of adds a different perspective, because every time you do see it, typically they are going for a true emergency. So with that kind of back of your head, kind of changes your perspective about it. It's not always just the fires that we change lives. It's also the medical calls that we go to as well. Yeah, when I was younger, you know, you see that go by and you're like, oh, they're going to a fire. And that's kind of a cool thing to do, is like, you want to be like them. They're making a difference. So, and that's kind of what you want to do. You want to make a difference.
You know, I think that some things are in the family, if you will, you know, family tradition. You see firefighters around and they've got brothers on and dads and uncles. And I think that's a valid thing. For me, probably going to stop with me. I don't really foresee them, you know, getting into this, which that's fine. As long as they're a productive member of society, that's all that matters to me. But what I would tell people is, I mean, even when I worked as a plumber, I worked at a good place, but we didn't have near as much fun as what we have here. You know, we'll text each other on our days off. Well, what are you doing? Or what's going on with this? And we just, the closeness that we have is just great.
So a department our size, we have just about over 50 people, and I think it's a good size right there, because it allows you to interact with everybody there and still know their name on a personal level and still get to know them. You go to a bigger department, sometimes you don't necessarily know everybody at all their stations. So it's kind of nice that here everybody knows each other by their first name, they know their family. We've all interacted outside of work, which is huge too, because that also helps build that camaraderie. It's one thing being here and trusting each other, but when you get to see them on the outside perspective, outside of work and more relaxed and kind of, you know, in their natural environment, if you will, it kind of builds that bond that, you know, you're building with people outside of work.
When we're on duty, we pretty much stay within district, because we cover 22 and a half square miles. It's an L shape. We start getting too far away, you know, your response really struggles, and we can't have that. So like we get together for different things, like during the summer, we'll get together for picnics, and whoever can get together for our shift, you know, we do that. We get together at Christmas. We have a nice Christmas dinner together. And we'll do stuff like that off duty, or occasions where we'll go to hockey game, or we'll go to baseball game or whatever. And that's a special time, because then a lot of times the spouses and the families get involved, which that's there again, that's what makes that special. But for us to get together as on duty, we don't do that. It would be awesome, but you know, last year we ran almost 5,000 calls. The 2 years prior to that, we ran over 5,000 calls. And if you break that down for all of our shifts, we can have, you know, half a day where we don't run a call, or we can just be crisscrossing all over the place, and you just never know. So we've always got to be ready. So we have a mutual, what they call it is a mutual aid agreement. And there's areas where, you know, we'll run a certain distance into Wyoming, they run a certain distance into Kentwood. So if we were to get like a possible structure fire or get something, they would automatically be on that alarm. There's times when, you know, we do that with Grand Rapids, and we have it with Cascade, and we have it with Colorville and Dutton, and we have all of our neighboring departments, all right? And it's a good thing because we help each other out, right? And then sometimes we actually will run into those municipalities and run calls for them when they're tied up and they don't have the resources to get to them. So that's kind of a nice thing too, because they will reciprocate that to us. If we're tied up somewhere, we have a fire or something, and all of our equipment is in a certain area, and maybe we can't get to it very quick, they'll turn it over to a neighboring department and they'll run it as a mutual aid call and they'll cover that for us.
I think any kind of call that involves pediatrics is a call that kind of sticks in the back of my head. Typically, we don't like running calls that involve kids, because a lot of us have them, and you know, I think it hits home at times, and it's, you know, all the pediatric calls that I've ran, I remember them, but it is, you know, as long as you give your best and you do what's right for the patient, I can sleep at night.
Yeah, I'd have to say kids' calls are the worst. A couple things that just stand out in my mind is kids' calls and just needless accidents that happen, just people being careless. Obviously, somebody's doing something, they're being careless. Maybe they don't think they're being careless, but, you know, we see things, we kind of get an idea on that. And in the beginning, it was a little difficult because, like, my family was, well, you coming over for Thanksgiving? Oh, you're coming over here for Christmas, right? Well, if you got to work, they don't quite understand that, because people have Thanksgiving off, or maybe they have Christmas off. So they don't understand the schedule right away. So that's a little bit of a work in progress. When your spouse needs help with the kids or whatever, and you're not around, and you're not going to be around till the next day, it makes it a little different. But you start to learn to adapt to that. One of the nice things is that we have days off during the week where my kids have done things with school, and I've been able to go on field trips with them. So I've done things that some other dads aren't fortunate enough, you know, to go on, and that's been great. And as my kids get older, they understand that getting together as a family is important. So if I do work on their birthday, we're going out on another day for their birthday. It's not really celebrating the day, it's celebrating them in that time. To work here, we have Fire 1 and 2, which is like the minimum that they would give you, like if you were to just apply at a department. And then we're also all EMTs. Certain people that we've hired have gone past that, and they've gotten paramedic license. We do not operate as paramedics, but we also have a certification in hazardous materials.
Each call has its own different kind of variables. It's hard to pinpoint what's going to be life threatening or what's going to be, you know, your run of the mill call, because any of these calls can turn into something that they're not.
Last year we ran 5,000 calls, and you know, you could take and divide that up between 365 days, and you can find an average, but there's days where maybe we run, you know, 3 or 4 calls, and then there's days where maybe we run 10 calls, because there is no routine, but that's just what makes this job so great.
A typical fire, about an hour, but not every fire is typical, and not so I would say, yeah, an hour would be a good reference point, and we've been on fires that have lasted 8 hours, 9 hours, you know, just the magnitude of the call.
We wear a suit that's made of Nomex, which is fire resistant, but it protects us from the heat, you know, from the fires. That's the nice thing with technology. Now, you know, we get to a fire and we get a little protection. Got to remember that we're getting into a burning building. We got to be really careful that we're not in there too long. It's nice because with technology, the bottles have gotten a little smaller. They've gotten a little lighter, but they carry about 30 minutes of air in them. And that helps out.
I think too, the thing that we got to remember too is we have all this equipment. The person that potentially is trapped in the fire doesn't. So it's our job to, you know, effectively and efficiently search that house and try to find them to remove them as quick as possible. Because not only do they not have any protection, there's all that smoke and all that dangerous toxins in there and stuff that's not conducive for life. We are here for the citizens of Kentwood. And that's what, you know, if you call, we're going to come and help you out the best that we can. We've had kids who locked themselves in a bathroom we've come there and helped them unlock it. So, you know, and it ranges from everything, not medicals, not always fires, not always technical calls. It's wide variety. Times you kind of have to play that the therapist almost, or psychiatrist.
Yeah.
I mean, what's the word?
Mediator.
Yeah. You have to. There's situations where, you know, one might be mad at the other and one has a cut and now they're yelling at each other. And so we have to tend to that emergency, but also try to keep them apart and try to figure out what the best course of action is. We're not police officers, but we're also an advocate for patient care and an advocate for them.
Yeah. So there's a fire safety message that we push, right? Working smoke detectors, everybody should have them. There's no reason to not. Call your local fire department. If you don't have them, tell them, hey, my house doesn't have enough smoke detectors, or I don't think they're working. Call them, they'll come out. Working smoke detectors, working carbon monoxide alarms, right? Being careful with all of the stuff that you have in your house. Don't have anything by your stoves. Be very careful when you operate your stoves. Have exit drills in your home. We go into all these schools in October, November for Fire Prevention Month, and we teach them about fire safety, and we talk about exit drills in the home. Have a plan to get out, have a meeting place, right? Get out, call 911, don't go back in. And that's the basis of it right there.
Another thing too is to close your doors. At nighttime, it's better to close your door at night, because in case you do have a fire, you're gonna have less fire spread to that room. And then when you're leaving, try to close your doors as well, because it'll help contain that fire in that room, ideally. Now, there's obviously circumstances where that doesn't happen, but you're usually in a panic and you want to get out as fast as possible, but closing your doors can help affect the limit and the spread of fire. It's a new thing. I shouldn't say new, but it's a thing that they are trying to promote and push better, is the whole mental health in the fire service and any kind of first responder, police. They have seen a lot of suicides in this job, just due to the amount of like stress and the types of calls that we see. It starts building up. And I'm, you know, the older firefighters out there typically used to hold their feelings back, suppress them, not talk to anybody, when really that's not beneficial at times. It's easier to talk to somebody and get that information out to help you help other people.
I'll speak as from being on the station, because we're watching each other. We're that close. Somebody's having a bad day, you can tell. I pay close attention to the people that I'm working with, because they're very important to me, right? Because at one point or another, we're gonna do something, we're gonna be out there together, I'm gonna be relying on them, they're gonna be relying on me, we gotta be there for each other. And I think that what Andy said with the mental health aspect is a huge deal. So I'm watching out for each one of the people here, and each person is watching out for the other ones, because you may pick up on something, and that's huge, because yeah, that never used to happen. Or I can't say never, but that really wasn't in the forefront. So the firefighters that are here, the family that they have a home, I give them a lot of credit, because I'm sure at some point or another, you know, they do take stuff home and that's what they have to deal with. So I give them a lot of credit. And I know what's helped me out a lot is just the crew that I work with, because, you know, and there's times I tend to get a little excited, and it's really nice to be able to feed off these guys to where it helps keep me in check as well. And that's part of that too, where we all kind of watch each other.